Welcome back to the Fantasy Hockey Podcast. I'm your host, Gamby, with my co-host, Brandon, and this is the most anticipated episode of the season for both us and for all of you. This is what months of preparation comes to. I mean, actually, it's probably a few weeks, maybe 2 months at most of preparation, but it's just after doing so much research, after pouring into teams, after really looking at a ton of different projections, we finally get to our sleepers episode, where we give you guys the players that we're watching as deep sleepers, as the people that you're going to get and be absolutely thrilled, and it's going to help you win your league. Straight off from the draft, you're going to have a huge advantage if you pick some of these guys. Now, before we get into the episode, we're close to the season. Draft season is right around the corner, so I wanted to go over just very briefly all the different ways you can kind of engage with us, and on top of that, get ready for your draft. So I would, one, recommend, if this is your first time listening to us, go back and listen to our other episodes, the bust episodes, the safe picks episodes. There's also a strategy episode that I'll recommend listening to. You can find those, obviously, on the podcast, or if you prefer YouTube, you can find them on our YouTube channel as well. Also, just fantasyhockeypodcast.com, or you can, yes, fantasyhockeypodcast.com. That is our site. We also have a Discord channel with almost 500 fantasy hockey fans. If you ask something in there, it gets answered literally immediately by like three people. We have people all the time posting, hey, should I make this trade? Or we have a rate my team channel, or there's all kinds of hockey talk happening. And it's amazing that someone can go on and get an answer nearly immediately. And it's completely free. So you can find that on our Twitter at fantasyhockeypd, or you can find that on our site, fantasyhockeypodcast.com. I also built a little draft tool that you can use. And so that can also be found on our Discord. We have a specific like tools channel where I'm constantly fixing bugs or adding kind of requests that anybody has, or saying whenever I update the ADP, all that kind of good stuff. And you can find that on our site as well. Am I missing anything, Brandon?
I think you covered it pretty well.
Yeah, I think that's just about it. So those are kind of the ways that I'd recommend to engage with us: Twitter, Discord, our draft tools, listen to our podcast, obviously. And other than that, I think you'll be really, really set to go if you kind of follow those things. So let's jump into the sleepers episode. Now, for this one, we want to give you more players than we normally do. So if you listen to our busts one, our safe picks, we limited to about like 8 players per each of us. And that was mostly because we wanted to give some analysis, explain why. And so we're going to keep the discussions a little bit shorter for this one, give our reasonings. If we disagree, we'll have a little bit of a discussion, but if we agree, we'll kind of let it be. But we want to give you more sleepers than we normally do. So we're going to keep discussions a little bit to a minimum. We're happy to go deeper into those on Discord or on Twitter. So if you have any questions, ask us on there. But otherwise, we want to give you the most players possible. So I've talked enough. You're probably sick of hearing my voice. So I'm going to let Brandon give you probably two of his sleepers so you don't hear me as much.
All right, let's start out. The first thing that comes to mind, actually the first few of mine here are actually really early picks. So for them to be sleepers, it shows me that the second and third rounds of this season are a little bizarre. There's a few guys that are falling to these rounds that are either first round value at least, or should be first round picks. And I'm kind of surprised they're not. The first one on the list here is Taylor Hall at 29.3 ADP. I think he could easily get 90 plus this season. That's first round value, I think. And I wouldn't suggest taking him in the first round, but again, I do think he's first round value. So taking him in the second round and at an ADP of 29.3, that puts him firmly in the third round, even in 12 man leagues, even in 14 man leagues, that's a third round ADP. So I absolutely think taking him in the second round is a fantastic option. Left wing is not the, deepest position either. So he can, it'll be good to shore that up early with a guy that, you know, is going to give you reliable results. He's getting faded a little too hard for having an injured season last season, but what can you do? I think 29.3 for his ADP is crazy. I can't believe it's that low.
Absolutely insane. He reminds me a little bit of Eichel, who we talked about in the safe picks episode, where it just doesn't make any sense. There's not really anything to indicate. And sure, people can be afraid of injuries, but it was a major injury. Major injuries to me don't kind of play into that much, the injury scare. And his line mates are still good. He's got Nico Hischier in the middle and most likely Palmieri on his right wing. And let's say it's not Palmieri and it's Gusev. Who cares? It's still a great wing to have.
And you know what? I'm going to do my next one because he's right in the same ADP wheelhouse, and that's Blake Wheeler. We mentioned him in the safe picks, but I think that like his, and we actually mentioned Taylor Hall in the safe picks, but these guys are safe picks because they're so early on that it's hard to call them sleepers, but they're also sleepers. Both of these guys need to be in the second round or higher, probably the second round, unless you're in like a 16-man league. But you should be able to safely get either one in the second round, and if you can get the other one in the third round, more power to you. But right wing eligibility, Wheeler is good for 90 again, I think. So once again, I think that puts him right around first round value. His peripherals are going to be pretty decent. He's the real deal. I don't know why his ADP is as low as it is.
Okay, for me, I'm going to start off also with the high name. My first one's going to be Brayden Point. This one is shocking to me.
I am shocked.
This one's shocking because when we did our team previews, I think the player that I most thought would be going too high this year would be Brayden Point. I even said it on the when we, I think, previewed Tampa, and I said, I don't think there's a chance in hell that I get Brayden Point this year. I don't think so. And for whatever reason, his ADP is at 48. That feels way too low for me. I know there's kind of fear that he's going to get, you know, moved off of the line. He might get his own line this year. And so there's fear there. But even with that, almost every kind of situation in which I've kind of plugged in stats, plugged in projections, looked at points only leagues where goals are worth four and assists are worth three, I've looked at standard Yahoo Cats, I've looked at, you know, leagues with PIMs and blocks and all that, and every single one, Brayden Point is ranked much higher than his ADP, usually about 20 spots higher. And I get that he's a center, but he's getting faded way too hard, in my opinion, for the potential upside that's there. His floor is fine, especially with that power play that he's on, and the upside is tremendous. So I don't really understand exactly why he's going as why he's getting faded as hard as he is. It doesn't quite make sense to me.
I'll be honest. I feel like for a guy like Point, it's just the historical data that like he hasn't been consistently at the levels we expect him to be. And so a lot of these models won't quite adjust for him for what the reality is now. And I feel like that's why we're seeing his rank be a little lower than you might expect. You wonder why that didn't happen with Line A last season, but who knows? Okay, my next one here is another early one, probably my last early one. He also could have been in the safe picks. We didn't mention him there, but it might have been an oversight actually, but I think Evgeni Malkin at 33.2 that's like the end of the third in a 12-man league. I've tried to get him in pretty much every single mock and every single actual draft I've done so far because he could easily be a first round value if he plays even 70 games. It's good enough. If he plays 70 games and he covers playoffs, I'm perfectly happy with him missing 12 because he has given you above point per game pace for several seasons in a row. There was an article on The Athletic that came out about Malkin, which was talking about the Malkin and Kessel kind of dynamic. And there's a few other syndications have also put out their version of the same article. If you have the Athletic subscription, check that article out. It's really insightful. It's really interesting story about what was going on between Kessel and Malkin. And I found it really eye-opening. But one thing I didn't like about the article is they kept mentioning how horrible the season was for Malkin. And we're talking about a season where he was still above point per game. So yeah, he missed some time, but come on. How can you call it like they used words like hellacious about a point per game season? If you're talking about that on a player like this, if a point per game above a point per game season can be described as quote unquote hellacious when he played over 60 games, you know, you're talking about one of the elite players in the league. And the fact that he's going at the end of the third round when he has such a proven track record, despite the injuries, is just mind blowing to me.
Along those same veins, a similar player that I'm surprised is getting as faded as hard as he is Gabriel Landeskog. Kind of that same hard-hitting type.
Well. Yeah.
He now has center left wing on Yahoo as well. So he was just left wing before. He finally got center. The center left wing now is a huge advantage. And one of the weird things with him is I'm not quite sure why he's being faded here. Last year, he was incredible. We all know that. So perhaps people just think he's going to be someone has to fall on Colorado, right? That's everyone's thought is, the whole three can't be that good this year. And so who's the one that's going to take the fall? It's Landeskog. He's a guy that honestly is another one that from the fifth, you know, 43.9 is his ADP. That's late-ish fourth round in a 12 person. It's a guy who could have first round value. He really, really could. And especially now at center left wing, that makes him insanely, insanely valuable. And you're looking at high power play points, high peripherals, high point totals. Like, he's got it all. And I don't quite understand why he's going 43.9. I think he's more of a late second round guy in a bangers league, especially in, you know, potentially, you know, standard Yahoo. I don't quite understand his falling. And especially more so than Brayden Point, where Brayden Point is only a center. When he has that left wing, I don't really get why he's falling that far. And so to me, Gabriel Landeskog is potentially one of the biggest, one of the only, if not biggest, people that I'd reach for in a draft towards that like second, third round time. I would happily reach for like a Gabriel Landeskog type in a bangers or standard Yahoo Cats kind of league.
Especially if you have face-off wins. Yeah. He takes a lot of draws, and that's why he got the center eligibility. There was a little bit of clamoring about him last season where he was taking a ton of draws, and they're like, when's he gonna get center? And they just never quite gave it to him. But now you got it. So if you had, if you kept him, I bet you're happy.
Oh yeah.
Okay. I'm gonna move in. I'm finally gonna jump some ADPs here. So we've been talking about guys that are, you know, 40s or above so far. My next one is, and I'm doing this in order for mine anyway, my next one is 87 ADP at the moment, Keith Yandle. Now, I briefly mentioned him in the safe picks, or maybe in the bus, because I mentioned John Carlson a little bit because he was going so early. When you have a guy like Keith Yandle, who's very, very similar, and for standard Yahoo leagues, their peripherals aren't going to be very different. They shoot, I think Carlson might have a slight edge in shots, but it's not by much. And I think their power play points are probably going to be pretty similar. Florida power play is just fantastic, and Yandle showed that he's more than capable of quarterbacking it. So I think all the tools are there, and you're seeing him be five rounds later than Carlson, who's a very, very close comparable in my opinion. So 87, you know, that puts him the beginning of the eighth or so in a 12 man league. So, I mean, if you take him in the mid to late sixth to the early seventh, you're going to get him for sure. And he's got a lot of tools to give you. Now, if you take him, you have to realize if you're in standard Yahoo, which I assume most are, he's not going to give you a ton of hits. So you will need to figure that out. And that's kind of the downside of taking a defenseman, that because that's an easy way to get those peripherals is via defenseman. So you'll need to make that up somewhere. But the power play upside, you can't get power play points on defenseman easily. And he is one of the premier at it. I get that it was a 39 power play point season last season. Yes, I agree that won't happen again, but he could flirt with 30 just as easily as John Carlson can. So if you're looking for a Carlson type and you miss him, I would kind of breathe a sigh of relief. You have a backup plan.
Okay, now moving on to, so I'm going to take two here just because I have two Ranger players next. One is Mika Zibanejad, 78.5 ADP, and Chris Kreider at 156.7 ADP. So two things there. Let's start with Mika Zibanejad. Now, I get he's a center, and again, you know, center is getting faded for, you know, whatever reasons. That's odd. Well, not for whatever reasons, just because center is so deep. But Mika Zibanejad is one of those guys that I would be purposefully targeting at center, especially in a bangers or standard Yahoo Cats league. Even in a points league, potentially I would eye him quite a bit just because of his high upside in points being on Panarin's line. And whether he gets Buchnevich, who he had good chemistry last year with, or Capo Caco, you're still looking at a really good right wing situation. So that top line in New York should be really, really good. And Mika Zibanejad is good as driving his own offense as well. He'll obviously be top power play. It'll also be top line for the rest of the year. Most likely will stay healthy. And so there's a lot of point upside there. And especially if you're in a bangers league, there's just so many peripherals for him that it's insane that he's falling as far as he is. He reminds me a lot of another sleeper that we'll talk about a little bit later at center. But he just offers so much, covers so much ground from a categories perspective that he's one of those guys that I'm definitely kind of highlighting and saying, I'm happy to reach for this. I'm happy to fade centers early, kind of, and then grab like a Zibanejad later and maybe reach a round or two before for a Zibanejad type of player. But he's just one of those guys that gives you so much coverage, it's hard to find guys like him. And on top of that, you have all the upside in the world with him. I think with Zibanejad, you're looking at pretty much the same season as last year. That would be my expectation, is that you're looking at pretty much exactly the same numbers he put up last year is what he's going to get. Of course, there's a sizable increased potential there with a better power play, but nonetheless, I think the safe thing to assume is that he's around the same. And if he's around the same, remember how insane he was last year. that's not worth 78.5 ADP. So in my opinion, he's a guy that if you're listening to the podcast, that 78.5 ADP is probably right if you take centers early. But if you've been listening to our strategy episodes and are kind of fading centers a little bit, Zibanejad is one of those guys that you 100% target way before his ADP. As for Chris Kreider, he's just a great player to get really late. He's one of those guys that is going to give you, again, a lot of coverage and has a lot of upside. And I know a lot of people are afraid of his trade, but that's fine. If you're worried about a Chris Kreider trade, be excited about his upside in the first half of the season. He's most likely going to be playing with Kakko on his wing now, as we know. So there's most likely going to be Kakko, and then it's going to be one of Howden or Anderson who's going to center him, most likely. It may be a Strom, but it's looking more likely it's going to be Howden, I think. I think it's going to be Howden second line.
It'd be Heedle, couldn't it? He plays center, right?
Yeah, could be Heedle. I haven't seen them... I should look this up, but I haven't seen anything about Heedle being a center this year. Seems like they want to play him on the wing. So I think that third line would be Heedle, Anderson, and Kravtsov. So that's what I think. I could be wrong. And of course, a lot can change in camp. But the thing with Kreider is he has a pretty stable second left wing spot and top power play and a lot of peripherals to boot. And so Chris Kreider at 156.7 is way too low, just insanely, insanely low for bangers leagues and, you know, the standard Yahoo Cats and all that kind of good stuff. He's should not be going that low. And my only reason that I could think that he's going that low is the fear of that second line. And him getting quote unquote demoted, even though he's still gaining Kakko on his line. So that's not much of a demotion there. And Kreider in his own right is good at driving play. So that line should be good just because he's on it. And on top of that, I think the other thing is, like I said, people are afraid of a trade. And from what I've read, I don't think Kreider is going to be gone anytime in like the middle of the season. It seems like it's going to be a trade deadline thing or an offseason thing. So I think that he's a perfect target too to grab. And if you're smart, you can kind of sell him high at a specific point. Pay attention to when he's doing well and try to sell him high. And he's one of those guys that you could potentially sell high for not that much. Like, you don't need to get that much back for him, in which you're saying, okay, cool. Like, I'm happy with this trade. There's a lot of options later on with Kreider. And for that reason, I really like Kreider as both a movable piece. You're getting him really late where he could maybe even be a bench guy. He's been a bench guy in a lot of my mocks, and he's a fantastic guy to have on your bench. And he just covers so many categories that he's worth it. He's like a budget Landeskog, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah.
Without the faceoff wins, of course, but he reminds me a little bit of like a budget Landeskog.
We talked offline briefly, and I wanted to mention that I was talking about John Carlson, not Eric, in case there was any questions about that in the comparison to Keith Yandle.
Probably an important distinction.
But next up, I've got another defenseman here. At 101.5 here, ADP, is Dougie Hamilton. Now, he's a sleeper for more than one reason, I think. The biggest reason he's a sleeper is Falk trade stuff. If that happens, we can see him have a major breakout. We could see him get 60 plus with fantastic peripherals, which will make him one of the premier elite defensemen if that happens. Even if it doesn't happen, you get solid peripherals with him. He could still wind up top power play, even if Falk stays. It might not happen, but it's possible. And he covers a lot. That's the big thing, right? In standard Yahoo, you're looking at hits. He gets good hits. You're looking at shots. He gets great shots. And he'll get you a decent amount of points, which, again, if he gets a power play, will go higher. The second thing I like about Dougie Hamilton is if you don't get him, that trade for Falk might happen mid-season. In fact, I think it'll happen possibly trade deadline-ish if they decide they don't need him for some reason or that they can get good return. Or if by some crazy way they don't make the playoffs, which it won't happen. But I could see him being a move at the trade deadline, especially if they want to acquire some sort of scoring talent. Maybe the Kasha thing actually happens. Who knows? But if that happens, then you could wind up targeting Hamilton late as a trade option when he hasn't hit his full potential, which is an interesting route to go because obviously the trade deadline ends and then you wind up in fantasy playoffs right off the back when Hamilton will be in a stride in the best possible scenario you could be in if that trade happens. Lots of ifs there, but at 100 ADP, his floor is still so high that it's just worth it. You can get him a couple rounds before that. Something like the eighth round is where I like to target him. And there you go. You've got a guy whose floor is already baked into your eighth round pick, and his ceiling is like it could literally be up to a second or third round pick in standard cats. If that trade happens at the beginning of the season and he gets top power play all season, I could absolutely see him be a top five defenseman.
My next two are actually same team again. So I'm kind of pairing together these two guys similar. And that's how it is for a few of these. But just because I think certain lines are getting faded for whatever reason. You know, you see them, you see Zibanejad and Kreider, obviously not same line, same team. But in this situation, it's one that I think is going to be the same line that's getting faded. That's going to be Mike Hoffman at 112.7 and Vincent Trocheck 159.1. Let's start first with Mike Hoffman. I think he's going to get second line. For whatever reason, Daily Faceoff has him as third line right now. I don't see Vetrano taking over that second left wing spot over Hoffman. I expect that to change significantly. But if it doesn't, I still don't hate it.
He still played some third line time last season. I hope it doesn't happen because it's silly. But
yeah, I hope it doesn't happen. But if not, if it does, it's I think he's still fine. And one of the reasons is because he's still going to be that top power play next to Yandle. Kind of also QBing it with Yandle, and he's got the shot for it. And so for me, I think Hoffman, what you see is he has such a rare skill in goals. He's such a good goal guy. And once you get down to that 112 over 100 ADP, the hardest thing to find is goals.
Mm-hmm.
Hands down. And so for me, Mike Hoffman is just somebody who is a sleeper simply because he offers such a rare cat so strongly. And on top of that, he shoots a lot. So it's these two things, and he's on the top power play. These two rare things that you don't really find late, or it's hard to find late. And so for me, Mike Hoffman is just a sleeper in the sense that you're looking at a guy who maybe, depending on your league settings, 112 is somewhat okay value. I think he's more of like an 80th round in the standard, or 80th pick, you know, in a standard Yahoo Cats, maybe a little bit higher. But just that goal coverage is so strong that is hard to find anywhere else. Now for Vincent Trocheck, he's similar to the Chris Kreider aspect, and he's getting hurt by one thing alone, and that is that he's going to be on the second power play. I think people are freaking out a little bit too much on that.
Yeah, I agree. I love Trocheck this year, where he's at.
Trocheck's incredible for this year. I mean, he's incredible for literally like any league, whether you're looking at points only or whether you're looking at like standard Yahoo Cats or banger league with Pims and whatnot. But I think in a bangers league is where his real value shines, just because he gives you so much stat coverage and it's so across the board for him that you can't find that anywhere else. And not to mention that you're probably going to be getting him maybe as a bench guy. I mean, this is again why I'm saying, you know, fade centers. Like if I look down on my list, there's so many centers here that quite frankly will, you know, Vincent Trocheck could very easily in a bangers league end up top 40 skater. Very easily could end up top 40 in skaters, and he's going 159.1. And so that's a center you can grab late and be like, okay, well, cool. I didn't have to take a center in the fourth round because I got Vincent Trocheck. Of course, that's a risky gamble, but that also means you can reach for him quite a bit, and it wouldn't even be that much of a reach because say you grab him in the 10th or 9th rounds. So what? 10th or 9th rounds usually are like throwaway players. It's not a guy like Vincent Trocheck. I think the lowest he's going to go in a banger league is probably like 60th rank. Probably around there is like his floor. Yeah. And that's if like points go drastically wrong.
His floor is 50 at best. It's crazy. Yeah, I mean,
it's insane how much coverage he gives. And like Brandon was saying, we were talking about this offline, but it's kind of, there's so many injury possibilities. Like if anybody gets injured on that top power play, the number, aside from maybe Keith Yandle, because they'd want to put defenseman there, but aside from Keith Yandle, everybody else, whoever gets injured, Trocheck is the first one to go up. Hands down. And that second power play unit isn't awful. I mean, you're looking at Aaron Ekblad, probably Borgstrom, Frank Vetrano, and then Owen Tippett, if Tippett makes a team. That's not a bad second power play. I don't hate that. And they have a really good power play coach. So I wouldn't be worried about that. Well, actually, I think they lost their power play coach. Did they not to Toronto?
They did.
They did. So curious to see what happens there. They do have Quenneville. But there's one last thing I want to say about Trocheck. And this is about coaching. So John Quenneville is now the coach of the Florida Panthers. And if you look back at his tenure, the way he liked to play normally was that he had a Toews line and a Kane line. The Toews line was more of a shutdown line in a way, but not so much a shutdown. They were still offensive just because Quenneville's teams in general were offensive. But what you saw is that they'd get more defensive zone starts. They'd play tougher opponents. They'd play the harder minutes. And that was the Toews line. I suspect that that will be the Barkov line, just because Barkov is so good on both ends of the ice. And then there was the Kane line, the line that got all the offensive zone starts and was its insanely offensive scoring line, right? And I think that he's going to do similar things in Florida, because if you look at the structure of the team, it's pretty similar. You can play Huberto Barkov and Dadonov as more of like a tougher minutes role while they're still scoring points. And then you have a Trocheck line that's a little bit sneaky, especially if you have Hoffman on that line. It can score goals and you can deploy it quite well as an offensive line. And that would help Trocheck a ton if he was getting a ton of offensive zone deployment and being played as a scoring line. So the upside is there. The upside is tremendously there, in my opinion. And 159 is just way too low. And honestly, he could end up being potentially one of the biggest steals of the year in bangers or, you know, Yahoo Standard Cats leagues.
Totally agree. Another thing to take into mind, like, obviously, we're doing quite a few positional leagues this season, so we're talking a lot about positions. If you do not use positions, all these centers need to be moving up fairly dramatically.
100%.
Trocheck is like the easiest one. Like, what is he doing in the 150s? Like, especially if you don't have positions. Last season, we were talking about drafting this guy in like the third or fourth round. It's just, and now he's like, he's probably not getting drafted in several drafts. Like, yeah, probably, I would assume it's at the ADP he's at, I would say he's probably not being drafted in about 20% of drafts.
Yeah.
For him to be that low. So that's mind boggling.
The other thing to note on that positions thing is if you have like two util spots or something like that,
yeah,
then that's similar to where you have, you know, forwards. Positions don't matter as much as the util spots go up. As the util spots go up, positions, like having to worry about, oh, can I fit a center in? Can I fit a left wing in? Doesn't starts to matter less and less. And so that's another thing to note.
Yep. You know what? I'm going to mention a center as well in Sean Couturier.
Oh, yeah, I have him too.
He was, I swear he was a sleeper last season, and I think he was even, like, his ADP was better than it is this season. He, like, dropped somehow, despite having another near point per game season. I don't understand. He's just good. Just flat good. Stop thinking about it. He's worth being rostered. He's at it, when I saw it anyway, he was 117 ADP, which puts him 10th round, which is low for what he brings, which is point per game-ish. And also decent, like not great, but he'll get you a hit every other game. He'll get you a block every other game, which adds up eventually. He's not a Phil Kessel giving you seven hits on the season or whatever. So I really like Couturier. His power play numbers should be really good. He's going to get to play with Giroux again, which is great for Giroux because he continues to be able to play wing, which we've seen him ever since they moved him to the wing. Giroux has been way, way better than he was at center as far as point production. So yeah, I still remember when they finally were saying, "Oh, okay, Couturier is getting a top center slot," and this is probably 3 years ago now. And RotoWorld projected that he might go point per game, and I was like, "Nope, there's no way." And then, of course, he did. So, and he's been doing that ever since. And yet, there's still a bunch of me's from 3 years ago going, "Nope, no way. Yes, yes way. He will be like an 80-point guy." So stop fading him so much.
Yeah, and I think another thing to remember with someone like Couturier is he puts up a lot of points. He gets a lot of points. And so, for example, when I plugged in some stats into like my projections and took a look at, let's say, just a points league where it's 4 points for a goal, 3 points for an assist, Couturier jumps up to third in the list. Or 30th, sorry. Third.
Can you imagine? Wow, he scores that much?
Jeez. 30th. He jumps up to 30th, and his ADP is 114.6. So don't sleep on him. And when you look at it from a consistency standpoint, he was insanely consistent last year. He got a great grade from us on our consistency score. He was super consistent. And so there's not any fear there either where he's going to go invisible at some point during the season. That's not really who he is. And it was the same thing in the 2017-2018 season. So there's not much to worry about for Couturier. And quite frankly, I agree with you. I think he's going way, way too low. And jumping into another center that's
One more side note about Couturier. Oh. If you're in a face-off league, especially if you're in one that gives you a point for a face-off win and one losing a point for a face-off loss, Couturier has been pretty dominant in the circle. His last three seasons, starting from the 16-17 season, he was a 55% face-off guy. Then he dropped a little bit to 52.8. His last season, he took the most draws of his career, or just about the most draws of his career, and wound up at 57%, which is elite. That might have actually been higher than Ryan O'Reilly last season, who like continuously wins this thing. So 57% with significant amount of draws, that should bump him up your numbers a little bit if you are in a face-off league.
Yep. And another guy, another center I want to move into that I think is similar to Trocheck and that he is the biggest, I think this is potentially the biggest sleeper across all kind of cats, regardless of points or bangers or anything like that. I think the biggest sleeper of the year is Dylan Larkin. I feel like this is the second year this. Mm-hmm. But Dylan Larkin has to be, he's at 132.1 right now. It's insane. I don't think there's a league in which I haven't put in, you know, different categories or stats or whatever where he isn't like top 30. The dude is a monster.
It makes me, the thing that's making me more annoyed by this is that his, how good he is not being reflected in, I'm just going to put him on blast, the NHL.com mocks. Yep. I get that you want to draft with ADP, but he was falling below his crazy low ADP already in their mocks. It's enraging.
Yep.
for them not to give him a nod, but whatever. Yeah.
And he's insanely consistent, puts up it. He's had two good years. I mean, this is the second year in a row that we're saying like, go after Dylan Larkin. Last year we said it and look what he did. And last year, a big reason too is because his time on ice shut up like crazy. He had 21 minutes and 51 seconds of average time on ice last year. I don't really see that changing. And I see the power last year, his percentage on the power play for his team went up a lot too. The year prior was 45.6% of the team's power play time he was on it. Last year he was 57.5%. And I would expect that to go up a little bit this year, probably in like the 60 to 70 range, I think is where we'll see Dylan Larkin this year for the power play. Dylan Larkin to me is, I don't think there's much conversation that needs to be had about him. I think he just is across the board, I think, the biggest sleeper of this year. Everyone's talking about Svechnikov. Everyone's talking about who are some of the other sleepers that everyone's kind of pointing to? Gusev, I guess, who we'll talk about later and everything. But the one to me that just screams like absolute will be good, and I have no doubts about it, is Dylan Larkin.
Yeah, I'm actually looking at the draft, the last mock they did. I think the first mock they took him in the 12th round or something, just unforgivable. And this most recent one, they took him in the 9th round, which is still pretty low. I think most sharps are going to take him above that. But they took Ryan O'Reilly in the 5th. As much as I like Ryan O'Reilly, I don't understand.
If you're taking Ryan O'Reilly in the 5th, then Larkin is like a second round pick.
Yeah. Like Ryan, unless it's a face-off league, but I'm pretty sure this is Yahoo standard cats. So
yeah, it doesn't make any sense.
It is. It was Yahoo standards cats. Like it. I don't, I'm actually mad now. I guess maybe they're trying to predict plus minus. I don't know. Anyway, draft Dylan Larkin, get him in the 7th round.
Yes. Like a reach or something. You can reach. I mean, you can reach like wherever for him. Like I implore you seriously to go and like download our tool or whoever you're thinking of using for projections and go see where Dylan Larkin lands in your league, because I would bet a lot of money that almost no matter your setup, unless it's some silly setup with like shutouts for 20 points or something, or shorthanded points for like 30, Dylan Larkin will be towards the top in almost every single
week. One other thing to mention about Dylan Larkin real quick, because I know we've gone on and on, but literally he's the guy to talk about when you talk about sleepers. But if you go on our YouTube, can you just go youtube.com/fantasyhockeypodcast? Does that work? Probably not. I think you have to use it or something. But anyway, the fantasy hockey, if you just Google or rather YouTube search fantasy hockey, we should show up pretty early on. Look at our expert draft that we did where we drafted Dylan Larkin in the 7th. In that league, we almost missed him. And we're talking about a guy that's, you know, projected to be a 11th round pick. We drafted him 4 rounds early and we almost lost him.
And when we had the projections, we had him ranked, I think it was top 20.
Yeah, I mean, like, he was obviously you could draft player. Him earlier, but this plays into the draft strategy episode, which we have. If you haven't listened to, you should listen to that. Why you don't do something like that, but you still have to reach. You have to find that golden moment to take a guy like Larkin, where a lot of people that are paying attention will know that he needs to be drafted ahead of his ADP, but they're all trying to find the right moment. And for us, it was the 7th round. If we picked later, we would have almost certainly missed him. So, yeah, Dylan Larkin. What a guy. You know what? I'm gonna stick with that team. My next mention here is going to be Anthony Mantha. He's sitting at 150 ADP, which again, that's like right on that cusp of probably not getting drafted in a bunch of leagues. He's left wing, right wing eligible, which when you're that deep in your draft, a lot of teams are going to be looking for that flexibility. But even if you're positionless, he's a guy that needs to be drafted. We saw him turn it on when he got on that Larkin line at the end of last season. It seems like anybody that plays with Larkin turns into gold. We saw Gustav Nyquist do really well on his left wing for a while there before the trade. We saw Mantha really turn it on. I think Mantha and Larkin are a pair this season. I don't see them breaking them up again. I think Mantha is going to excel in that role. I don't know that we're going to see him be like anywhere near Larkin's, you know, point per game-ish pace, but he should be pretty good and certainly good enough to warrant being drafted. The fact that he's looking at like a 13th round pick here is what? Why? Once you're there, you should be gambling, and Anthony Mantha is not a gamble, and that's the takeaway here. I don't think he's a gamble at all. I think his upside is very high. I think his floor is super reasonable. I don't think he's going below 55 points this season. Yeah, Anthony Mantha. I love him this season. And he gives you hits.
I like that take a lot.
And he's going to be top power play, which, whatever. We don't know about Detroit's power play yet, but it should be bad, honestly. But it shouldn't be that bad that, like, you know, he's still going to get power play points. He's going to get not zero power play points.
Okay, let's move on to a team that got ridiculously better this year. Let's talk about the New Jersey Devils.
Oh, I know where you're going with this one.
There's three guys. I have three names here for the New Jersey Devils that matter.
We haven't argued yet, so I wonder if this is coming now.
Maybe. Kyle Palmieri.
I will
Nikita
not argue
Gusev,
that one.
And Nico Hischier.
Wow. Okay, no.
Those are the three that I have.
Kyle Palmieri, I can definitely see. I didn't put him on my list, but I do have Gusev.
So Kyle Palmieri is pretty self-explanatory. Fills out all your cats. Shoots a ton. Is going to be top power play lock, pretty much. Top line lock, in my opinion. I think they want to keep that. I think they want to keep Hall and Palmieri together. I think there could be maybe a rotation on the top line. I'm not so sure, which I'll get into when I talk about Gusev. But anyways, Kyle Palmieri is a guy that, for whatever reason, people are fading insanely hard. And it doesn't really make sense when he's poised to play with a guy like Taylor Hall. And part of me questions like, okay, people are clearly fading Hall quite a bit here. And obviously I'm going to talk about Nico Hischier. They're fading Hischier. And so obviously it makes sense to also fade Kyle Palmieri. Now, from a points perspective, he doesn't have the sexiest pace. I'll admit that. He's been on kind of like a 55 to 60 point pace the last, 4 or 5 years, something like that. He's been on kind of that same pace. And I think that one of the parts that hurts has been time on ice. And I think his time on ice could increase a little bit this year, which could help. I think also he finally has Nico Hischier at center, which is good. Nico Hischier is tremendous at driving play. He'll probably have a fully healthy Taylor Hall, we hope. Last year he was healthier than he's been in a bit. He played 62 games the year prior and then 74 last year. And before that, he had played 82 and 80. So I expect him to be healthy this year. I expect him to be on kind of like a 0.7 point per game pace. So you're looking at around, let's say, 60 points this year, something like that. His time on ice on the power play increased quite a bit last year as well. Went from 247 to 318. So played 60% of his team's time on the power play. So I think that'll also increase a little bit this year as that top power play gets better, most likely. And so everything kind of points to Kyle Palmieri being really good this year, especially when you look at a Bangers League or standard Yahoo Cats. There should be no fears there. And so Kyle Palmieri to me at 148 feels way too low, especially at right wing. Okay, moving on to the center of that line, Nico Hischier. Tremendous, tremendous player. I mean, one of the best kind of rookie play drivers out there from everything I've read on different people. He's really, really good. He's probably locked for top line, I think. I think they want, my inkling is that they want to keep Hughes and Gusev together this year. I think that with Nico Hischier, we talked about this in the Devils preview, so I won't get into it too much. But to me, from everything I've read, is that Nico Hischier has proved himself. And he's been really good. And like we said, sometimes there's real life situations where a guy may not be the best in fantasy. And so us in fantasy will say like, oh, well, but Hischier is like an okay player. He shouldn't be top line. But then when you dig into the stats that underlie it, he is really good. And he's one of those guys that you just can't really make a case to take off of. It's like Backlund, the same thing. Just really good from a advanced stats perspective. And what happens is that Hughes is going to have to do a lot more than just score points to overtake Nico Hischier. And that's kind of the issues. And I don't think Hughes can do that. Or I think it's unlikely that Hughes does that in year one when they don't really have to. I think he potentially could be better than Hischier immediately. But I don't think they want to push him to do that. I think if you can have Hischier, who's good on the first line, and then have Hughes, who's, you know, developing still on that second line, I think they'd be happy to do that. So in my opinion, they keep Hughes and Gusev together for most of the year. And so you're looking at Nico Hischier, most likely, in my opinion, having a breakout year with Palmieri and Taylor Hall, and pretty much a lock on that top line. And he's going right now 170.4. So that's a fantastic guy that you can bet on late. And I have him probably more of, like, you know, in the 100 ranks or something like that. I think he's going to be totally fine. I think you could see a 60, 65 point season out of him. And then lastly here, Nikita Gusev. That one is pretty much self-explanatory. You're looking at one of the, we talked about this a lot in the Keaton Carlson episode. You're looking at a guy that is coming over with fantastic stats in Russia. I think he's more of like a Dadonov type. Him and Hughes have had crazy chemistry so far in the preseason. I don't really see any reason not to, to take him. And he's a left wing. If I remember correctly, I'm pretty sure he's a left wing on Yahoo. Yep. I always mix him up with left wing or right wing.
He's left wing.
So he's left wing, which is really rare, and he has so much upside, and his floor is probably 55, 60 points is what you're looking at for a floor for Gusev. And he's right now, it looks like he's going to be top power play. So you're looking at top power play, second line with Jack Hughes, which if you're playing with Jack Hughes, most likely means you're getting sheltered offensive deployment, which will most likely extend to Gusev. So probably limits his minutes to like the 17, 18 realm, but they're all going to be mostly offensive minutes, which is really, really good for him. And you have a guy like Jack Hughes passing to you. He's definitely not worth that 172.1 ADP. He should be going insanely higher.
You know, we talked about the big four rookies, which we'll delve into more next season, or next season, next episode when we go over rookies. But did you have Gusev as your top scoring rookie, or was it Hughes?
I had Hughes, okay. And then
well,
Kakko,
the rest of us.
And you guys, when we did the Keeping Carlson episode, you guys all had, I think, Gusev.
Yeah, all three of us had
rookie.
Gusev as the highest, and he's like by a wide margin the lowest of the four.
Yeah.
For like draft value. So I think Hughes and I think they're all grouped up right around 110 to 120 with the other three rookies in Makar, Hughes, and Kakko. But Gusev, there's no reason Gusev's not in that list. Like, if you're going to draft those three guys together, Gusev should be drafted with them. But he's the one that's being faded the most. And we're talking about a guy who's 27 years old. It's not like he needs to like adjust to playing with big guys or anything. He's not an 18 or 19 year old coming into the league. He's prepared. He's a full blown professional athlete for a long time. So yeah, I think, like you mentioned, his floor, I think, is higher than any of them. And his ceiling is maybe not higher than any of them, but it should be right around the same. So I think that Gusev is being faded weirdly hard, considering if you're going for a rookie to not take him. And I guess rookie is kind of a weird phrase to use for him, but technically he is one. He's just not eligible for the Calder because of his age. But yeah, I really love Gusev, even though I keep forgetting him because he's one of those guys. He's so low ranked on everything. Either that he's just not going to be of mind unless you are looking at a sheet that has Gusev in your face.
It's shocking how much people talked about him in the offseason. And then all of a sudden now in fantasy, he's being completely forgotten. I mean, I've had some drafts where he just doesn't go drafted. And even I kind of forget. And I'm like,
yeah, forget he's there.
Oh, yeah, I need him.
Yeah, so great late round grab there. So another, this is a player that I'm surprised he has not fallen anywhere near this far in our drafts. But again, we're a PIM league, so that kind of makes sense. But Brady Tkachuk. He's sitting at 154 ADP right now. That, again, when you're in the 150s and beyond, you're really looking at players that go undrafted in a lot of leagues, in a healthy amount of leagues. Even in Yahoo Standard Cats, he's primed to give you excellent shot and hit numbers. He's basically a discount Evander Kane, but yep. We don't know what his scoring upside is. Like, okay, he might get Evander Kane numbers and sit at that like 55 point range, which is still way good enough for this late. He's definitely getting top power play, which Evander Kane may not. So we may see more power play points out of Tkachuk, even if they wind up with the same point pace at the end. So Brady Tkachuk at as low as he's going is just mind bending to me. He's the best offensive weapon that the Ottawa Senators have, and it's not even close at this point. So you'd think that the play is going to go through him as much as possible.
Well, I mean, that answers it, right? Why are people fading Brady Tkachuk? The answer is really simple.
It's simply Ottawa,
and it's stupid.
But still, like, yeah, you don't need to, you're not drafting the team here. And I get his plus minus might be horrendous, but who cares? You're looking at a guy that's also plus minus, but you're looking at a guy who's, you're going to be able to get the end of your draft, who's going to give you literally eye popping peripherals. And especially if you're in a PIMS league, you should be slapped in the mouth for not drafting him at some point.
Yep. 100. I mean, I have him for 52 points, 192 hits, 33 blocks, 225 shots. Like, come on.
I honestly 80, think
80 something PIMS. I think he can outdo those points.
Yeah. I think him getting below 200 hits is an underestimate, which is insane.
Yes. Especially when you're on a team that bad, it means you don't have the puck as much. And it means that you need to hit or be physical to get the puck back. Of course, you could be skillful and get the puck back, but I don't think that's going to be how Ottawa rolls. I think Brady Tkachuk is going to displace people with the body. And Ottawa is not going to have the puck much, folks. That is almost a fact. And Brady Tkachuk is probably, I would say, the best player left on the team, pretty much, aside from Toews. And so Brady Tkachuk is a massive sleeper in standard Yahoo and Bangers leagues. I don't think he's a sleeper very much for points leagues, but for Yahoo standard catch Bangers, totally.
But he played 16 minutes a game, and I mean, you largely think that's because they started the season with Stone, among others, and Duchesne. So his time on ice started way low, and we saw it climb and climb and climb, especially after these trades happened. So he put up numbers that surpassed all of those paces, literally all of them, except for maybe points. Yep. He had 45 and 71, but that's pretty close to a 53-point pace. He was pacing above the shots, above the hits, above the PIMS with 16 minutes of average time on ice, which is going to go up probably dramatically. You add another couple minutes on there?
Well, here's what you look at. So last year in quarter four, so that's pretty much the fourth quarter is virtually right after the trade deadline, right? A few things that really stand out to me about Brady Tkachuk. So he had 20 games in the fourth quarter of the season. He played 17 minutes and 29 seconds of average time on ice. That's a big jump, and that's big over his 16 minutes. So you can expect this year he's probably in that 17 to 18 range, which is huge.
I wouldn't be surprised if he's an 18 plus even.
Yeah, that'd be insane. And what's crazy is that after they traded away Stone and Duchesne, he had 14 points in 20 games. So he was still good. He didn't struggle that much.
He had a 12-shot game in there.
Yeah. So, like, look, Brady Tkachuk, man, people are sleeping. People are sleeping hard on him. Okay, for me, I still have a few centers. Can you tell that there's a little bit of a trend here in why we've been saying, like, fade centers? Because it really is insane this year that there's no reason to take centers super early, or to prioritize taking centers early, especially if you see your mates not taking centers. I have two right wings here, not on the same team, but I think they're worth mentioning. Both very different types of wings. One doesn't need much conversation. It's Pavel Buchnevich is the first one, 171.3 ADP. You're talking about probably the last pick of the draft, last round of the draft. I think that's going to jump a little bit. You may have to reach a little bit for that, because I think that as this comes out, he's going to jump in ADP. But the thing with Pavel Buchnevich, and I've seen a lot of talk about him. A lot of people are like, well, if he stays healthy, well, Kako's gonna jump him or whatever. I'm not so sure. The thing with Buchnevich is he's never had a coach that just trusts him inherently and says, you know what, I'm behind you, and I'm gonna give you the shot. And last year he proved himself, in my opinion, and I think I said this when we talked about the Rangers in our preview, but I'm pretty sure I said that Buchnevich proved himself last year. He really showed that he could be a top line wing, at least for the time being. He really did prove himself, and I thought he deserved the top line spot. I love Kako. I thought, obviously, I should love Kako as a Ranger fan, but I think Buchnevich earned it. I think it's his to lose. I think he deserves to be up there. And today, this is being recorded on a Tuesday, but they had an interview with David Quinn, and Quinn went out of his way to say, don't look into the preseason lines. Buchnevich will be top right wing. And so I think that this year is going to be his to lose. And I could easily see him sniffing 30 goals, you know, 25 goals, whatever. I think he could have a serious breakout year. And on a guy that is last pick of the draft, last round pick, why not take a flyer on someone like that who's going to be playing with Artemi Panarin and Mika Zibanejad? I mean, why wouldn't you? So to me, Pavel Buchnevich is a guy who has tremendous kind of upside and not much risk, to be honest, just because of how late he's going. And he's a wing. The other guy that's similar to Buchnevich, just very different coverage and different reasons, is Dustin Brown.
Oh, yeah.
Why?
Dustin Brown's a great option.
Why in the world is Dustin Brown going 172.2? Oh, right. He plays on the Kings. That's it. He's just like Brady Tkachuk. People hate picking players on bad teams because they like to touch nice things, as we always say. People like to touch nice things, so they as I always say, they over-index on the Torontos, they over-index on the Colorados, they choose Soderberg over some bum who's on Ottawa when the bum on Ottawa is insanely better from a fantasy perspective than the, you know, shiny star in Toronto. This is why we say, you know, in a strategy episode, know your league. You got to forget about the real life. You've got to forget about what's happening in the Fantasy Hockey League, in the National Hockey League. What really matters, what you really got to care about, is how does it affect your fantasy league? And Dustin Brown is one of those guys that when you plug in Yahoo Standard Cats, he excels. He flourishes.
Yeah,
people are probably scared of the plus minus, but like we said before, I don't like drafting with plus minus. It's such a random stat week to week. There's no point drafting for it. I 100% advocate do not draft with plus minus. Pretend it doesn't exist. And when you do that, Dustin Brown becomes a top 50 player.
Yep. He's paced 2 years now in a row of 55 plus with very good peripherals.
Yeah.
So, and he's going to get top line again. What else are he going to do? So
he is also kind of like Larkin, I think, one of the biggest steals of the draft in a bangers or standard kind of Yahoo Cats league. He's someone who's not going drafted mostly. I mean, if you have a 172.2 ADP,
yeah,
you
that's
are
the
mostly,
end of the ADPs. They don't even count them after that, pretty much.
Yeah. So you're pretty much going undrafted for the most part. And you're talking about a guy who's guaranteed top line, pretty much guaranteed top power play with insane peripherals and has been consistent on a 55-ish point pace. I don't know what to tell you. If you don't want a player like that on your team, you got to go back to your projections and take a hard, hard look at how, you know, certain players affect your scoring.
Yeah. Well, I've only got one left here, and it is a goaltender. So I'm going to go ahead and say he's not much of a sleeper, but I think he's going a little below what I'd expect, and that's Semyon Varlamov. Now, we saw Lehner go in and excel in this system. And let's be honest, it was a system thing that had a lot to do with the success. We saw both goaltenders. Yes. I mean, Greiss played 38 games or something, 30-something games, and put up really good numbers as well, like career bests. So what's to expect that Varlamov won't have very good numbers? Now, I'm not expecting anybody to be putting up 930s or anything like that, but if you're looking at 110 ADP, which is where he's at, so you're looking at, you know, the 10th round, you're looking for your second goalie. And especially if you start with a guy like John Gibson, Varlamov pairs great with him. Yep. Probably going to have pretty good numbers. You're not going to get wins, but I mean, you have Gibson, so you're probably not really expecting to anyway. But Varlamov is a great complement to that. You'll get enough starts throughout the week with the two of them, and the numbers should be pretty good. So for him to go 110, I think he's a pretty solid second goaltender, especially depending on who you draft as your first goaltender.
Yeah, I would say he pairs really well with a volume goaltender.
It depends on what type. I wouldn't pair him with Jones because you might wind up averaging yourself out.
Yeah.
But if you paired him with like a Dubnyk, that could go pretty well.
So here's another thing on the system that we were talking about. When you look at the expected save percentages last year, both Lehner and Thomas Greiss had an expected save percentage of 92.25. That's really high.
That's awesome.
So that's like what you expect the goalie to get. And they overachieved in that, of course. And instead of putting up a 92.5, they put up a 93.34. Almost exactly the same save percentages as well. So a lot of this points to system. And I don't see why they couldn't put up, I don't think the expected save percentage of the team is going to fall this coming year. I think that they pretty much put up, not too dramatically. Yeah, and if you look at like Brayden Holtby, right, his expected save percentage last year was 91.58. If you go back to when Trotz was there, I want to actually go back and look at him really quick back when Trotz was there, because his expected save percentage when Trotz was there was 92.05. So pretty you're good. Looking again at when Trotz comes over, and that was Mitch Korn as well. So he over-indexed on that save percentage, but the expected save percentage was way, way higher than when Trotz wasn't there. So a lot of it does point to system. So I agree with you. I think the one thing that I fear with Varlamov is starts and injury risk. So one thing that scares me a lot about him.
Yeah, but okay, he's currently at a 10th round value in a 12-man league. You take up at the end of the 8th, worth, I think.
Okay, I'm going to finish off mine here. I have a few more. I have three more to talk about that are kind of just mostly in kind of bangers leagues. And then I'm going to specifically point out some players that I like for points leagues. Actually, you know what? All the players left here I like for points leagues as well. So that's talking about like if you have four goals and three assists, four points for a goal, 3 points for an assist, specifically for those because they don't really offer much in the categories anywhere else. So Jonathan Toews is one at a 138.9 ADP. The guy is insane, and not another kind of guy that I'm not really sure why he's getting faded after the season that he had last year. I get he's supposed to regress, but in 81 point pace last year, and he put up 81 and 82. And the new coach has said, I don't want to say his name, I think it's like Coliton or something weird, insanely consistent last year, and he wants to keep Toews and Kane together. From everything that I've read, is his whole thing is he wants to keep Toews and Kane as a pair. How true that is, we will see. But it seems to be that that's the case. The other thing that changed last year a lot for Jonathan Toews was that he played more time on the power play. He played 67.6% of his team's time on the power play. That's a big thing. And his minutes also jumped. He went from 1941 to 21 minutes. So a lot of that I would expect to stay the same. And so Jonathan Toews going that low to me is pretty nuts, especially for a points league specifically. One guy that for all kind of cats makes sense is Pierre-Luc Dubois. He's going at 162.6. Another, I get he lost Panarin. I don't think it makes that big of a difference based on where he's going. I think he's being faded way too hard for that loss, and it's again one of those situations where it's people don't want to touch Columbus, and Pierre-Luc Dubois is hurting a lot from that. His hits were great last year. He had a decent amount of shots, had a good 61-point pace, got 61 and 82. I don't know why I keep saying pace, but he had 61 and 82. And he's still, you know, he had a decent end to the season. Not great. He lost a lot of time on ice, but a lot of that had to do with Duchesne coming in. And so I think he's going to be fine. And I think if anything, in, you know, the 16th round or whatever he's going, he's a great center bench option that has point upside, is going to be top line, and he's going to be top power play, and he gets you good peripherals. And so for that reason, I like Pierre-Luc Dubois. And then the last three here that I'm going to mention are specifically for points leagues. So that setup that I was mentioning where you're kind of looking mostly at points, peripherals don't really matter. Anze Kopitar is one. Probably going to get, you know, 65 points somewhere around there. Has a lot of upside if the Kings can kind of figure out that top line and get a little bit better on the power play. Ryan Johansen is another one that gets tremendous amount of points. The power play should get better. He's going to be that top line. He gets really, really generous offensive zone starts. So he's a scoring line. He'll have Arvidsson on his line, most likely. Oh, and my cat tried to knock over my mic. Cat always messes things up on the podcast. So Ryan Johansen is a really good, really good option. 167.7 ADP for Johansen, 148.5 for Kopitar. And then the last one here is Sean Monahan. I feel like he gets faded every single year. And if you're in a points league, you got to be paying attention to Monahan. And Monahan's a funny one because, you know, we've been talking about people not wanting to touch bad teams. For some reason, he's on one of the best teams in the league and people don't touch him. It really makes no sense. Last year, we saw his minutes jump a little bit by about 20 seconds a game. Matters quite a bit. He played less time on shorthanded, which has been kind of a trend in his career recently. Played more time on the power play, or actually, sorry, about equal time on the power play, about similar share, and had a ridiculous pace yet again for points. And he's still going to be playing with Gaudreau. The team, really, I don't see any reason that they will slow down. Of course, we talked about this in the previews that I see his assists coming down, but he still scored 34 goals last year. He's probably more of like a 14% shooter, so probably more of like a 25 to 30 goal scorer, or somewhere in that range. And his shots have been going up, which is good. So I don't think there's anything to be afraid of for Monahan, and especially in a points league, there's no reason to be fading Monahan as hard as he's being faded. You know, if you're looking at like a 70 to 75 point guy, compare that to where other 70 to 75 point guys go, it's definitely not in that 80 ADP range. So he's definitely someone to pay attention to. And that's it. I mean, special shout out to Ryan O'Reilly in faceoff wins leagues. Always gets faded too hard. And even in, you know, standard Yahoo Cats, he should be going higher than he is at 106.2. But again, that's kind of, you know, par for the course for centers this year. But kind of, again, points to what we've been saying all season long or off season long is fade centers. This is the year to take a defenseman early, the year to maybe take a goaltender early, and fade those centers and take elite wingers. Just there's so many centers late that can be good comparables that you're going to be okay in that position.
Wow, that was a lot of talking, but I can't say I disagree on any of the points, actually. So I especially like the Kopitar one. I actually tried to mention that, but my mic broke in the middle of that, so that's fun. Luckily, a little bit of resuscitation and I'm back. Okay, so I think that wraps it up. That's our sleepers. I think we probably gave you like 30 or maybe more, actually.
Yeah, that's a lot of sleepers.
Yeah, 30-something maybe. So tons of sleepers, tons of options, lots of late picks. Really, really into the mid and late game this draft. Like you're gonna be able to make great teams more than most seasons. I feel like I don't remember easily coming up with 15 without even really trying sleepers for the season. I could have gotten way deeper without, but you know, we don't want this to take 6 hours. So
yeah, I think this year with proper preparation and, you know, paying attention to the podcast, I mean, even let's say, you know, someone who doesn't listen to the podcast and just does their, you know, own numbers and kind of figures things out and plays it smart. I think you could this year you have a serious, serious advantage if you've done research and paid attention and asked questions and read what you can. Like other past years, I would say, yeah, I mean, you gain an advantage, but there's just not that many obvious ones where, like, you know, you say, OK, there's 10 sleepers and the odds of you getting those sleepers are somewhat low because a lot of people know him. This year there's just so many that you could build a really, really good team if you're planning the whole draft out, or at least trying to think out the whole draft.
So the one thing we want to mention here is our listener league entries are closing on Friday. That I mean we're going to close at like midnight on the 20th, so really the 19th will be the last time you can actually join Patreon and get into a listener league. We're getting too close to the draft dates, so we don't want to try to fill out these drafts at the last possible second, so that's going to be it. So if you want to be able to join a listener league, if you want to support us on Patreon, now is the time to do it. We'll slot you in no matter what, even if we fill up our last remaining couple of leagues we have going on here. Only a few spots left, but again, if you wind up in the window, we will open a league specifically for you and get it full by the time it drafts. So this is, that's it. You will still have, I mean, if you want to join Patreon without a listener league, there's still plenty of reason to do it. First of all, we love you for it, and that's the biggest one. We, again, won't paywall any of our stuff. We don't want to have Patreon be a gate of any kind. So if you join Patreon, it's mostly because you want to support us, and then also because of listener leagues. And then lastly, you'll have extra access to our Discord. And for Patreons, we give you your own channel, which we pay a little bit more attention to as far as answering questions and making sure that we keep up with you, and you'll be able to listen live as we record. So, and plus when we come up with things, we'll have more bonuses for you, as well as discounts on any merchandise we sell, which we have coming up very, very soon. You won't pay an extra dime in markup if you're a patron. And with that, I think that's it. Listener leagues very soon.
Thanks for listening to this episode of the Fantasy Hockey Podcast, brought to you by myself and my co-host, Brandon Stockenborg. If you liked this episode or others, please leave us a review. It's the number one way to help the podcast. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, @FantasyHockeyBD, join our Fantasy Hockey Discord channel, play in a listener league with us by becoming a patron, and check out all our tools on FantasyHockeyPodcast.com. All research courtesy of Dauber, Daily Faceoff, Hockey Reference, Hockey Viz, Natural Stat Trick, Evolving Hockey, and RotoWire. Intro song is by Avicii, and the outro is by Deadmau5. Thanks again for listening, and we'll catch you next time.